The following is a recording of a live questions and answers session with Chris McCann that took place on Monday, October 13th, 2014.
Hello and welcome in to EBible Fellowship Questions and Answers Time, where you can interact with us with your questions and comments related to the Bible, and we'll try to respond as well as possible by going to the Bible. And so, with our Bibles at the ready, it's now time to turn things over to our speaker, Chris McCann. Good evening, Chris.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to EBible Fellowship's Monday Night Question and Answer Program. During this time, each person is invited to share with us your question or comment, and you can contact us in one of the ways that were just mentioned, and we'll be glad to take your question or your comment, and I'll try to respond as much as possible by going to the Bible, as the Bible is God's holy word. Well, we have a short time together this evening, so we're going to begin right away by going to the first person on the phone tonight. Welcome to our question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Good evening. Ezekiel 39, verse 23. It seems like there's a lot of referencing that the heathen will know, or just Ezekiel 39, 23 and Ezekiel 54. Is there going to be more of a recognition of what has happened before, like the final last day, like more people? I mean, there are people now that say, oh, yeah, there's something going on. There's, you know, and I say it's Judgment Day. I tell them what I know. But it seems like, just like the caller the other day, there is a lot of people that are recognizing something is going on. So if you could just speak a little bit about those two verses, I'd appreciate it. And God have mercy on you, Chris. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
All right. Well, thank you for calling in. What was the verse in Ezekiel 16? Ezekiel 16, which verse? Hello? Oh, I think we lost the caller. All right, well, here in Ezekiel 39, 23, and the heathen shall know that the house of Israel went into captivity for their iniquity, because they trespassed against me. Therefore hid I my face from them, and gave them into the hand of their enemies, so fell they all by the sword. Well, I don't know what will the unsaved understand or know. I think we just have to be careful with this kind of language, because of for instance, this verse that was spoken to an unsaved man, and he was the high priest of Israel, but still an unsaved man. In Matthew 26, when he adjured the Lord by the living God that he say whether he were the Christ or not. And then it says in Matthew 26, 64, Jesus saith unto him, thou hast said, nevertheless, I say unto you, hereafter shall ye see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. And let's see, this word translated as see is 3700 in Strong's Concordance, and 3700, well, I was thinking it might be a word that means no, but it's translated as appear, look, see, show self. And yet God is saying that the high priest will see Christ coming, sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. And we know that he never saw this literally, but as the gospel witness was continuing from that point with the disciples, with Stephen, who said the very same thing or something very similar, in Acts chapter 7, when he was witnessing to the Jews, and they just couldn't stand it anymore. And it says in verse 55 of Acts 7, but he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God and said, "Behold, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God." Then they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran upon him with one accord. And then they stoned him to death. And I think what we can understand when Christ says to the high priest, "From now, hereafter, you will see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven," that's language of judgment. It meant that the witness of the Bible and the people of God that would testify to it and witness it in the hearing of Israel, that this would be the consistent witness of the Bible, that Christ is exalted into the heavens, that Israel is under the judgment of God. And we can see that they didn't accept it or acknowledge it. They even put their hands to their ears. They stopped their ears. And yet God says they would see it. And so along those kind of lines, that the people of God, first of all, the witness of the Bible is declaring judgment day. So Christ is coming in the clouds, and the people of God are testifying to this. And it doesn't mean that people are going to acknowledge it or receive it or anything like that. But the consistent witness of the Bible is to this this occurrence, to a judgment day beginning on May 21, 2011. But thank you for calling and sharing. And let's go to the next person on the phone. Welcome to our Monday night question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Good evening, Chris. How are you tonight?
I'm doing well. Thank you.
Chris, I was reading about the deception of the Gibeonites in Joshua. And I have a question on when the leaders of the Israelites find out, and they find out of the, they discover the stratagem that the Gibeonites and other people of the nearby towns had perpetrated. Joshua curses them. However, but then they are assigned to perpetual service in the God's house. So I guess God, I think God blessed them. And also we find these servants back also in Ezra in chapter 2 and in First Chronicles, where they are a part of the repopulation of Jerusalem. And especially in Ezra, was reading in chapter 8, verse 20, all of them, the number God gives us is 220 of these servants. And what is the symbolical meaning of their number?
Of the number 220?
Curse them, but then he makes them perpetual servants of the temple, of the sanctuary.
Well, 220 is a number that would break down to 2 times 10 times 11, I think. 2 times 10 times, yes. So those are significant numbers. 2 would point to the caretakers of the Word of God, and 10 completeness, and 11 to the coming of Christ to demonstrate the atonement. So it relates to the atonement. And the Gibeonites are an interesting people because they were deceitful. They used deception to trick Israel into making a league with them. And that's important. In Joshua 9:15, it says, "And Joshua made peace with them and made a league with them to let them live. And the princes of the congregation swear unto them." Now, Joshua is the Hebrew name for Jesus. So he's a picture of Christ. And it's also interesting that Joshua died at the age of 110, which is 10 times 11. And we have two of those same numbers, 10 and 11, that you said the 220 was related to the Gibeonites. Well, Joshua, who's a picture of Christ, makes a league or a covenant with the Gibeonites that allows them to live. They did not die like the other inhabitants of the land of Canaan. And so the Gibeonites are a picture of true believers. And then I'm not too sure about why it says you're cursed, except it goes on to say, and there shall none of you be freed from being bondmen and hewers of wood and drawers of water for the house of my God. And being a bondman is a servant to the house of God, hewing wood and drawing water for the congregation would be ministering to the people of God. It's a little bit more difficult to see with the hewing of wood, but with the drawing of water, we can see how they would go to the well and they would fetch a bucket of water and then bring it to someone in the congregation who needed water. And there is a clear picture of, first of all, God saves his people. He saves his elect. Then he commissions them to carry the gospel to others, to be a servant of the Lord. And so we bring spiritual water. So the Gibeonites are actually a very consistent picture of the true believers. Now, in the days of Saul began to kill the Gibeonites to try and drive them out. And that was contrary to the league, first of all, that they had made with Joshua, and therefore contrary to the will of God. Those Gibeonites pictured the true believers. And Saul is a representation of the corporate church that drives out the true believers when he was killing the Gibeonites. And then finally, Saul is slain, and there's a famine in the days of David, and David inquires of the Lord, what's the reason for the famine? And the answer is because of Saul and his bloody house, because he slew the Gibeonites. And then the Gibeonites request seven sons of Saul to be hanged. And to be hanged is to be accursed. And in the Bible, whoever hangs on a tree is accursed. And I think there, again, the seven sons would relate to the seven churches that as the true believers in the book of Revelation are crying out, how long, O Lord, holy and true, till thou avenge our blood? And then God did avenge the blood upon that was shed by the churches in judging the churches and congregations. And then God avenged himself of Babylon that he used to accomplish the first vengeance. But I think that the Gibeonites are consistently a picture of the true believers.
Thank you very much, Chris.
You're welcome. Thank you for calling and sharing. And let's go to the next person on the phone. Welcome to our question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Good evening, Chris. Could 2015 be the year of the Jubilee, or it is the 70th Jubilee?
What was that again? 2015?
2015, the year of the Jubilee, or is it the 70th Jubilee?
No, it's not a Jubilee year. No, 1994 was the 40th Jubilee since Christ was born in 7 BC, which was a Jubilee year. And 7 BC to 1994 is 2,000 years, 2001 minus 1, because there's no year zero, and 40 times 50. So it was the 40th Jubilee, a very important Jubilee. as God in that year poured out the Holy Spirit a second time. The first time was on the day of Pentecost. Throughout the church age, the Holy Spirit was poured out. And then after 1955 years came the end of the church age, the end of the first pouring out of the Holy Spirit, which was the early reign, then a time of famine, because that's the pattern in the Bible. There is rain followed by famine. It was the rain of the Old Testament followed by the famine, 1335 days of Jesus's ministry, followed by the early reign of the church age for 1955 years, then famine for 2300 evening mornings, followed by the latter rain for 6100 days, followed by famine of judgment day for a likely 1600 day period. It goes back and forth. There is rain and then famine, rain, famine in each season. The end of the Great Tribulation, the end of the latter rain, we would expect to, if it followed the typical pattern, because there was rain, famine, that there would be famine in the Day of Judgment. And that's exactly what we find. The next Jubilee will be, or would be, 2044 AD. It's every 50 years. So from 1994, 2044 is the 50th year. And that's why a Jubilee will not figure into the end any further other than 1994. 2044 doesn't fit anything. It's just too far away.
Okay, because I looked up the word Jubilee, and it comes from Yobel, Y-O-B-E-L, and it says at the blowing of the seventh trumpet.
Well, where did it say that at? In a dictionary? A Bible dictionary somewhere?
I think it was in Strong. I didn't write the number down.
It depends. There's a silver trumpet that is blown on the first day of the seventh month, and only on that month. And when it's a Jubilee year, that does signal the Jubilee. And that's why back in 1994, September 7th was the first day of the Hebrew seventh month, signaling the blowing of the silver trumpet to indicate it's a Jubilee. And then historically, the whole year would be a Jubilee. But in this case, it's a spiritual figure. A Jubilee is when the captives are set free. So it has everything to do with salvation. And Christ was the essence of the Jubilee when he was born in 7 BC. And so the outpouring of the Holy Spirit really resulted from that. And remember Jesus in Luke 4, when he was in the synagogue, quoted from Isaiah, "Proclaim ye liberty to the captives." It was the language of the Jubilee. And so in a way, the first Jubilee, Christ, or the spiritual fulfillment of the Jubilee, extended throughout the church age. And then a second Jubilee took place in September 94, a second outpouring of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for calling and sharing. And let's go to the next person on the phone. Welcome to our question and answer program tonight. Please go ahead with your call.
Hi, Chris. First of all, just a little statement. Those that have already gone to heaven are really rejoicing with Christ in a very personal way. They just don't have their body, right? I was going to get into Jeremiah chapter 15 and 16. In Jeremiah 15:19, it says, "Therefore, thus saith the Lord, if thou return, then will I bring thee again, and thou shalt stand before me. And if thou take away the precious from the vial, thou shalt be as my mouth, and let them return unto thee, but return not unto them. And if you go a little further down, in 16 it says, the word of the Lord came off unto me, saying, thou shalt not take thee a wife, neither have sons or daughters in this place. Is that like we're living right now? I mean, physically he didn't have a wife and kids, but this is talking in a spiritual sense that we're right there. We don't return to them. They come to us, if you will. But is that kind
well,
of where
well, much of the book of Jeremiah is talking about the judgment on the church during the Great Tribulation, and it's interesting. I don't think it was emphasized enough during the time when we learned the church age was over and it was time to come out of the church, that where God says here, thou shalt not take thee a wife, neither shalt thou have sons or daughters in this place, that we normally think of being unequally yoked as a believer and an unbeliever. Someone who believes the Bible and someone who doesn't. But really, you couldn't get more unequally yoked than the time of the end where we were in a great tribulation and now we're living in the day of judgment. Then for a believer who understands the church age is over to marry a professed believer who's in the church. It is probably asking for more trouble than marrying just someone who has nothing to do with the Bible at all, because every Sunday will be battleground. It'll be a fight, especially if there's children. And so we are not to be unequally yoked, and if anyone is qualified, male or female, and there's still nothing wrong with marrying. So if anyone is considering marriage and wants to do it God's way, then a believer outside of the church should not even look for a second and not even consider a believer or professed believer in the church. It would be the worst possible spiritual union you could think of, and it's just God is saving us or saving some people a lot of trouble and headache by saying don't take a wife, as he's speaking to I guess Jeremiah here, don't take a wife in this place, and that applies to us too.
Exactly. First Thessalonians chapter 5, when it says pray without ceasing, that just means stay mentally talking with God, if you will, thinking on him, like it says in 2 Corinthians 10:5, take all your thoughts captive to Christ. Also it says
actually, remember, God commands perfection. He tells us, be ye therefore perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. And so he commands us to do things that only a perfect person could achieve. And so when he says, 1 Thessalonians 5, which verse was that? In verse 17, pray without ceasing means pray without ceasing. And so as we go through the day, if we were a perfect person, we would pray without ceasing throughout the day, and so we desire to pray as much as we can. It is a form of looking to God, but God means exactly this. He means to pray without ceasing.
Right. And he also talks about despise not prophesying and sculpt not the spirit. And this chapter 5 is talking about the time of the end. So here we get all these new revealed prophecies that were hidden in the scriptures, and we test them. We'd be like Bereans, and if God will reveal the truth to us, he'll show us these truths that he's let you and others bring out so well. By the way, thanks a lot for your Bible studies. They've really been really good, and God is really blessed through Revelation 14. Thank you, Chris.
Well, thank you for calling and sharing and bringing up these verses. And let's go to the next person on the phone. Welcome to our Monday night question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Yeah, hi, Chris. I called earlier. It was verse 28.
Oh, of Ezekiel 16?
Yes. But then I read further in Ezekiel. I actually stepped out, but I'm still listening to the Q&A. Because God then references towards the end of Ezekiel, I don't have the book, but, you know, the Levites that went away from me, you know, even though I'm not with them, they're still going to minister. And this is in the last couple chapters of Ezekiel when he's talking to him about, you know, how, you know, the measurement of the temple gives him an idea of that. In one of the chapters,
your question about Ezekiel 16:28 again?
28, it's when he's going to bring the captivity back so they can bear their shame.
So they can bear their shame?
Yeah, 16:28.
Well, it says, thou hast played the whore also with the Assyrians, because thou wast unsatiable. Yea, thou hast played the harlot with them, and yet couldst not be satisfied. This is just typical language describing the spiritual unfaithfulness of Israel of old and of the churches and congregations, and therefore God gives them up to the ones that they were lusting after, to the world, to Satan, and that's the judgment upon them.
I don't think that was the right verse, because this one is saying that, yeah, I don't have it with me. I apologize. So I'll call back either Sunday or Monday.
Oh, okay.
Or probably Wednesday.
Okay. Well, that's fine.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for calling. And I would like to thank everyone for calling and sharing and for joining us tonight. It's always a blessing when we can turn our attention to the Bible for any period of time and consider what God has said to us through his word. But at this point, we are going to close our question and answer program this evening. Please keep in mind, this coming Wednesday night at 9:30 p.m., we'll have 1 hour text question and answer on Facebook. Sunday Open Q&A is the name of the group, and all are welcome. And then also again this coming Friday. Also, if you could, please keep in prayer this week on the 15th, the Radio Taiwan broadcast will begin into mainland China. Let's pray that the Lord of the harvest gather together his people and that they hear and that they're comforted, encouraged, that the sheep are fed in China and elsewhere around the world. But for now, I'll say good night, and may the Lord's perfect will be done.
And thanks for joining us again for eBible Fellowship's Questions and Answers Time with your speaker, Chris McCann. You can join us for these questions and answers sessions Sunday afternoon following Sunday studies and Monday and Friday evenings following the Monday and Friday evening studies. Until next time, may the Lord's perfect will be done.